So what we are going to do today is talk about consistency and replication. This is, I believe, a new chapter in the book on replication, consistency, and whatnot. I will talk about several different consistency models. A lot of what we are going to talk about, you can think of as theory, okay? In terms of what are the guarantees you can provide to an application in terms of distributed application in terms of consistency. The practice, which is what applications actually do, we will look at in a sequence of subsequent lectures when we do, let's say, the World Wide Web. We'll see how does the web actually guarantee, how do web applications actually guarantee consistency? What kinds of techniques that can be drawn from the theory we are going to look at today can be used in that context and so on. Okay? So today's lecture might seem a bit abstract, but you should try to understand what I'm trying to say, because we'll see how to apply it in real applications in the next several classes. Okay, so that's the background between what is going to happen today and what will happen subsequently. So let me start with replication, which is the basis for why we need consistency at all. Okay, so we talked about replication in the very first class. I was talking about replication, transparency, and so on and so on. Okay. So I'm going to briefly bring that back. So why would you need to replicate either data or computation in your distributed application? In your lab too, you're already replicating computation. Okay? Your front-end servers are being replicated. They perform computation. The computation in this, in your case, is very straightforward. You can just retrieve scores and update scores. But nevertheless, it's some form of computation. You are replicating it. Okay, why are you replicating it? So that the replicated server can serve a larger number of users. Okay? If you had only one server that was your front-end server, it would have a certain capacity. Okay? Basically, at a certain request rate, it will get saturated. Okay, if you replicate that across multiple servers, the hope is you will actually be able to increase the capacity of your application in terms of how many requests it can user requests it can serve. Okay. That's called replicating the computation. The process itself is replicated. Okay. You can also replicate the data. Okay. In your case, in lab 2, for example, the data is not replicated. Your back-end server is not replicated. Okay. There are both front-end servers which replicate the computation access data from the back-end node. Okay. So in that case, you can argue that eventually, if the back-end server was also doing computationally expensive queries, for example, that you might actually be a bottleneck. If you have 15 front-end servers and still this one back-end server, eventually all of those requests from the front-end servers will all trickle to the back-end servers. The back-end server might become a bottleneck in that case. Okay? So in truly distributed applications that are built to scale, you not only need to replicate the computation, which means the processes or applications that do the processing, you also need to replicate the data. Okay, there are multiple copies of the data, so each process can actually access a different copy and scale both the I/O system as well as the computation or the processing. Okay? So you'll have data replication or compute replication. Okay? Now, whenever you replicate data, you are going to have to deal with additional problems. And the first thing that you want to deal with, okay, is if one copy changes, if one replica changes because you updated the data, how are you going to let the other replicas know that there's such a change occurred? Okay. This is called a problem of consistency. In fact, that's what we are going to focus the most of the class on. Okay. But there are other benefits of replicating data. Easiest one to understand is reliability. Okay. If one server, database server crashes, if there is another one, let's say you replicated the database server as well, your data is not lost. You can go to that database server, access the data. This is in general true in any storage system, where if you have multiple copies of the data, if there's a disk crash on one machine or something else goes wrong, your data remains available because you have other copies. Okay? In many cloud-based storage systems, the replication is internally done. For example, you're soon going to do a cloud computing homework in which you're going to encounter Amazon storage service, which is called S3. Okay, S3 has internal replication. It replicates the data in multiple locations. You just ask for a copy of the data and it'll get you the data from some replica. You don't even have to specify which one. Okay? And it is replicated so that if some copies go down, others are available. And there are many examples of file systems that do that as well. Okay? The Hadoop file system, HDFS, Google file system, lots of these modern distributed file systems, some of which we will encounter in a subsequent class when we do distributed file systems, are also going to replicate data. Okay? They're all being done for reliability purposes. One replica becomes unavailable, crashes, the data still remains available. Okay? Performance, I already talked about data replication, just as your compute replication also gives you performance benefits, okay, in addition to reliability benefits. Okay? Now, there are many issues. Before we get into consistency, I'm going to briefly talk about replication issues, okay, something that you have to consider. Okay? So you have to ask, when do you want to implement replication in your application? Okay? How many replicas do you want to create? Okay? Where do you put these replicas? Okay? All of that is important. In your lab 2, for example, if you are told you need to sustain a certain request rate, you have to decide for that request rate how many replicas do you need. Is it 1, 2, 3, 4, depending on the capacity of each replica, you have to decide how many replicas to maintain. Okay? Now, where to put the replicas is not as important in this case because all the replicas are part of a single cluster at one location. Okay? But in many distributed applications, you can put the replicas in many different locations. When we encounter web-based caching, you'll see that you can put web caches that replicate some web content in many different locations around the world, and you can then go to the closest replica to get your data. Okay? So in that case, it matters where you put the replicas, not just how many replicas you create. Okay? So those are all issues to think about, as we said here. We will come back to this in the context of our worldwide web discussion when we talk about caching and content distribution and think about these issues more carefully, okay, but not for today. Okay? Instead, what we are going to do today is look at orthogonal issues. It says if you have replicas of your data, multiple copies of the data, maintaining consistency of that data is an important problem. Okay, if you have an update or a write to one of the copies, how do you update the others, okay, so that they are all consistent with respect to one another? This is called the problem of maintaining consistency. Okay? So one copy is modified, others become inconsistent. What do you do in that case? Okay? Now, before I go into consistency techniques, there is a result I would like you all to know, which is called the CAP theorem. Okay? CAP is an acronym that stands for consistency, availability, and partition tolerance. So let's say you have some distributed application. Okay, you want to provide good properties to the users of that application. Okay? So you will say that maybe there's replication in there. So you want to ensure consistency of your data. Okay? All nodes see the same data at the same time. That's what consistency means. Okay? You want availability, which means that failure of some nodes does not take the entire system down. Okay? Some nodes can fail, but the system as a whole continues to operate. Okay, that's called availability. Okay? And partition tolerance says that if the network gets partitioned and some nodes become unreachable, the fact that they cannot communicate with one another should not impact the operation of the system. In other words, the system cannot tolerate message losses. Whether those message losses occur because the network is not reliable or the network is partitioned doesn't matter. Okay? So you want, ideally you would like those properties because in a distributed system, okay, you might have updates, so things might get inconsistent, or you might have failures, so nodes may go down, or the messages may get lost. Okay? But now what this CAP theorem says is that if you design a distributed system, okay, you can only get two of those three properties. Okay, you will have to pick which two you want. You can't get all three. If you pick two, the other one is not possible. That's what that theorem said. That's why it's called a CAP theorem. It was proposed as a conjecture, okay, by a researcher who's a distributed systems researcher from Berkeley. Okay, and he gave several real-world examples to explain why that is the case. For a long time, it remained a conjecture. Then, under certain scenarios, some theoreticians went ahead and proved that that conjecture actually holds, which is why now it's called a theorem. Okay. Now, I'm going to give you some examples of what this means, okay, but you should understand that in a distributed system, okay, you cannot have all those three properties simultaneously. Okay, if you pick the two, so if you say, I want Consistency and fault tolerance, typically then the way you design your system, you have to assume that the network is reliable. The network cannot lose messages. Okay? Or if you want to say, I want consistency and reliable network, then you cannot assume that nodes will not fail, or et cetera. Okay, so here are some examples of why that conjecture actually came about. Okay, so obviously, the distributed system designers, when they design new systems, they would like to take techniques such as replication, consistency, and put it together in the system. But many researchers since, but originally the people who proved this or proposed this, what they noticed is if you take typical systems that have been designed so far, okay, and you analyze their properties, you only get two of those three properties. Okay, so for example, if you have a database cluster or you take two-phase commit, you have consistency, two-phase commit we haven't done yet, we will come to it. You assume that you will have consistency and availability, but you have to assume that the network is reliable. If there's message losses, then those techniques no longer work. Okay. If you take things like a distributed database or a distributed lock, okay, consistency and partition tolerant is possible, but you don't want to assume failure. Okay, so when we talked about locking, I said things get really complicated if the lock manager fails, for example. So you don't know the lock state at that point. Okay, dealing with that is really a problem. Okay, and so what that says is, okay, consistency is easy because that's a lock, and partition tolerance is fine, but if the nodes fail, then you cannot actually make it work in a good way. Okay, so that tells you that in that case, getting availability in addition to those two properties is actually hard. So, and the same is true in terms of large distributed system. If you look at DNS, okay, basically you have the ability to have high availability. You can actually deal with messages getting lost, but what you sacrifice is consistency. Okay? Essentially, if your network gets partitioned, if some data changes in the replicas on one side of the partition, it's not possible to relay that information to the other side of the partition because the messages are not flowing. The network has actually gotten partitioned. So you can't have consistency in that case. Okay? So these are just examples. I'm not going to give a proof of this. Okay? They're just examples for you to understand that when you design distributed systems, you would like to have some good properties for the application, you have to keep this rule in mind that you essentially have to. There's a picture here which is showing the same thing. And there are many more systems here that have been described. Pick this off from the web. You'll see consistency, availability, and partition tolerance. And you'll see along each of these, if you have A and C, you have all these systems. These are our database systems. And you'll recognize some of them. There's MongoDB and Bigtable and Cassandra and MySQL databases, which all of which you may have heard of or used, but they give you different properties. Okay, they cannot give you all three. You have to pick which two, and based on that, if you can't see in the back, don't worry, I will make this available. It's not very visible. It's a dark background, unfortunately. Yes, your question there.
Can I have an example for partition tolerance? How like this actually happens?
What is partition tolerance? Is that your question?
For example, yeah.
Okay. Question is, what is partition tolerance? Partition tolerance simply means, let's say there are some nodes in a distributed system. Okay, they are connected over the internet. Okay, so let's say that's the connectivity. Okay, that's how they are connected. Okay, now if you see that if this link goes down, okay, the network essentially partitions into two halves. These nodes can talk to one another. Those nodes can talk to one another, but these nodes cannot talk to these. Okay. Simple way to think about it, let's say you have Wi-Fi network in your home. Okay. It connects to the internet over a broadband router. Okay. Let's say your internet connection goes down. Okay. Within your Wi-Fi network, you can communicate. Outside your Wi-Fi network, nodes can still communicate, but nodes inside cannot talk to the nodes outside and vice versa. That means your network is partitioned. That's an example of
these nodes are replicas of data.
In this case, this is just saying what is network partition. But now in our case, if these are replicas, okay, and let's say there is an update to a node here, okay, that no update can be propagated to this other node since some data has changed, but because the network is partitioned, you cannot tell these other nodes until your network comes back. Okay. So you cannot have consistency if your messages are not flowing back and forth. That's a simple example there. Question there?
I'm having a hard time seeing why availability is not present for distributed data databases.
Can you repeat your question?
I'm unable to see why availability is an issue in distributed databases.
Why is availability an issue? Is that your question? So what this is saying is, essentially you can get, that depends on the distributed database as well. So the question is, why is availability a problem? You'll see in this case that there are many different databases. I'm not going to go into most of them, they're all cloud-based databases. But in some of these cases, you will see that in this case, there's MongoDB. Okay? So basically it gives you consistency, it gives you partition tolerance, but it does not necessarily give you availability guarantees, which means that you can keep your replicas consistent, you can deal with partitions, but if nodes go down, you cannot actually get availability either. Okay, so that's basically what it means. For distributed lock, I gave that example, saying if nodes go down, you cannot actually operate your system reliably. Okay, some of this will become clear when we start talking about things like two-phase commit and so on. Because if you want all the nodes to agree on something, and if some nodes go down, then you will not be able to agree. If you need, let's say you're voting and you need 100% of the votes, and some nodes are down, then you cannot make progress if those nodes cannot actually vote in the system. And some of these actually use those techniques. Okay, we will come back to that as well, but that's the intuition. There's some question here, yes.
Do people like measure each of these things and say, maybe if I compromise to this extent on like availability, can I have like that much more or something?
Okay, question is there any work to say I can relax this along this dimension, some consistency, and I get something more on the other dimension? The answer is for specific systems, you can make that trade-off. There's no general rule saying if I relax property A by 20%, I get to 30% more of that, because it all depends on the assumptions you're making for the application.
So I have a question with regards to the diagram. So on the other end of the diagram, availability and partition tolerance, there are a few examples like CouchDB and SimpleDB. So
yes.
Why would a database not want consistency?
Okay, the question is, there are lots of databases mentioned here, but if you look at availability and partition tolerance, your databases that are not giving you consistency. Okay, in that case, what that means is you're not getting good consistency guarantees. Okay, we'll talk today about consistency. We'll end up with something called a very loose form of consistency called eventual consistency. Some of those things actually will do that. In fact, that's what the best way to understand that is also here. Okay, you can take the example of DNS. DNS is just, you can think of it as a very large database that has host name to IP record mappings. Okay? There is no consistency assumptions made there. You can make an update. It will take up to 24 hours for that update to propagate. Until then, things may be inconsistent with respect to one another. You do this because you want other properties, because nodes might be disconnected. It just takes a long time. It's very expensive to implement consistency. So there will be some systems that will relax that guarantee. Okay? If your application needs better guarantees than that, you should not use those databases. Okay? But it is actually a good question. We'll come back to when we talk about eventual consistency. You'll see consistency is a hard problem. So you want the weakest possible that's good enough for your application. Okay, other questions? Okay, so keep this in mind. Okay, this is something to keep in mind as you go along, do work elsewhere to know what properties you can get. Okay, but we are going to switch gears and come back to consistency. Okay. I mentioned that there are, you cannot get all three, but let's just focus on, if you wanted to focus on consistency, what are you doing? Okay, so we'll assume now that there are replicated objects, there are updates coming to objects, and we want to see how can you ensure that other objects are synchronized so that every replica sees a consistent view. That's our goal. There are many ways to do this. Either you do it at the application level, you might do this at the middleware level. For the purposes of our lecture, it doesn't matter. Okay, who is doing the consistency maintenance? We want to understand what consistency guarantees can you give. Okay? So to understand some of this consistency guarantees, I would like to explain the issues behind replication and scaling, because we'll see that that's also related to this notion of. Okay. So here is an example. This is an example actually taken directly from web caching, which we are going to see in a few lectures, okay, in the context of the world right now. So we'll assume there are multiple copies of some data item. We'll assume that you are replicated it to improve performance. Okay. Now, you might say if some copy, let's say it's web page, okay, you cache that web page in 10 different locations. Okay, let's say the server goes and updates that web page. Okay, so the web page has changed. Let's say the newspaper site. Okay, there's an update to the newspaper site. So all the cached copies are out of date at this point. Okay, so to maintain consistency, you might say, let me, every time there is a change, I'm going to just send that updated version of the page to all the replicas, so that the replicas are consistent. That's the simplest thing you can do. Every time there's a change, you are going to send an update. Okay. Now, if there are lots and lots of these copies, you will realize that sending updates is going to be expensive. Okay. If there are 10,000 copies of this web page cached everywhere, okay, every time the server makes a change to its web page, it has to send 10,000 messages to all of those sites saying the caches or replicas saying the web page has changed. So there is an overhead to maintaining consistency. You have to propagate update messages to all the replicas to say the data has changed. Okay? And sometimes that is not worth paying that much expense, because it all depends on the relative rate of how frequently users are accessing the web page to how frequently the web page is changing. Okay? So let's say, to make this very concrete, let's say you look at the website for New York Times or CNN. Okay? It's a very popular website. You will probably have millions of users accessing. Okay? So the read frequency is very high because lots of users access that website. Okay? Now, how frequently does that website change? Maybe the front page changes every 5 minutes, every 10 minutes, because they might have a breaking news section that gets updated frequently. Okay? Now, if you have lots and lots of users and data is changing every few minutes, it may be worth the trouble to actually send those updates every time the web page changes. So your users always see fresh content. They always see the most up-to-date version of the New York Times or CNN front page. Okay? Now take the opposite example. Let's say you have a website that is not at all popular. Maybe you have a blog but nobody reads. So you might be updating it a lot. Okay? But there are no readers. So maybe in this case, the write frequency is very high, higher related to the read frequency. So you update it maybe, or maybe it's your Twitter page, doesn't matter what it is, but maybe you have no followers. So you update it frequently. Now, if you are going to waste all these messages sending updates over and over again and keeping all the replicas consistent, but nobody is reading from those replicas. Okay, this is a toy example, but the relative idea is the same thing. Saying that you are writing far more frequently than you are reading, but then if in that case sending all those updates is actually wasteful. Because you go update those caches, nobody reads it. And then you change it again, you send an update, but nobody has read it, and so on and so forth. It's the exact opposite scenario to the first example, which was there are a lot more readers than writers. Okay, there are lots of people going to New York Times to read the page than how many updates are coming to the page. And vice versa, there are a lot more frequent writers than readers. Okay. So depending on which of those two things is true, you want to pick the right consistency guarantee, because maintaining consistency comes at an expense. Okay, so this is what it says. The read rate is much smaller than the write rate. This is the example of this blog I was going to mention. You have high consistency overhead and wasted message. And the other is true. That's actually you are paying the cost of high consistency, but it's worth the trouble. Okay? So this is going to become important when you're thinking of web pages, because the popularity of web pages actually has an exponential distribution, where some websites are really, really popular. And there are millions and millions of websites that are not at all popular. And they have a few users. Okay. Now, if you say, I am going to keep the same consistency guarantees in my cache for all of those websites, you may be doing a lot more work than is needed to maintain the consistency of some web pages that nobody cares about. then you could have easily relaxed that consistency guarantee. Still nothing would have mattered from a user's perspective. So what this very simple pathological example should tell you is that consistency will come in a range of flavors of how strict guarantees you provide or how weak the guarantees are, and you have to pick the right one that actually is relevant to the application. You shouldn't say I'm going to pick the strictest one possible every time, because it will come at a very high cost. And these things might matter when you have very large scale distributed system. Web is a good example of that. Okay. So that's the precursor to say, okay, if you do not want to give the strictest possible guarantees to everything that's replicated, what other options do you have? And we'll see that there are lots and lots of options, and that's what we are going to talk about. Okay, any questions of this? Okay. So this is the model to keep in mind. Okay, so there are copies of the data. They are replicated across multiple sites. Users are going and accessing the data from whichever replica they want. Okay? And they can update it, they can read it. And the question is, if some process here updates the replica here, and then very soon after that process tries to read the same data here, what should they see? Okay? Ideally, if you have something called strict consistency, you should see the most recent version of the object, but there are many other options as we will see. Okay? So, basically, ideally, you want to return what is called the results of the most recent update. You want to have the most up-to-date version of the object seen at all the replicas for the best guarantees. Okay, but that's not always going to be possible. Then let's start with the simplest model, which is called strict consistency. As the name suggests, okay, any read in your system always returns the most up-to-date version of that object. So in our web caching example, there may be lots and lots of copies of a web page cached across lots and lots of sites. Any user goes and accesses a web page, they will always get the most recent version that is basically equivalent to the version at the server. That's called strict consistency. Okay? Now you have to realize that strict consistency itself is very hard to achieve in a true distributed system, because how do you define what is the most recent version of the object? So let me give you an example. So let's say New York Times goes and updates its web page at 10 a.m. Okay. Let's say 1 millisecond after 10 a.m., some user tries to access the web page in some location. Okay. You should ask, what is the version they should see? You will say, ideally, if that happened after 10 a.m., they should see the update that happened at 10 a.m. Okay. But now if I tell you it takes 10 milliseconds for that a message to go from the server to that cache at the speed of light. That's the network propagation delay. Okay. The best the server can do is, as soon as there's an update, it sends a message to the cache saying my data has changed. But you cannot beat speed of light. Okay. It's going to take you 10 milliseconds, let's say, speed of light to get that update over. Okay. How can you guarantee that 1 millisecond after that update happened, that you will actually provide the most recent version? Is it even possible to do? You see the problem I am put. So I mean, you cannot beat network propagation delay. So strict consistency is not always going to be feasible in the real sense, unless you make additional assumptions. So it's hard to achieve. Okay, that's something you want to keep in mind, because network delays are going to be variable. Of course, there's the whole notion of synchronization. Okay, how do you even know the message that appeared at a different site is 1 millisecond later from the origin, because that assumes you have a globally synchronized clock to even compare the two timestamps? But even leaving that aside, the network propagation delays are finite. Okay, so you cannot instantaneously tell all your caches the objects are changing. Okay, so that's hard to achieve, strict consistency. So what are some loser ones? So we'll see a sequence of loser definitions to consistency. They'll all do worse than strict consistency in different ways. Okay? Yet they allow you to figure out what properties you're actually getting from the system. Okay? So this model here, the second one, says it's sequential consistency. Says it's weaker than strict consistency. And in this case, here's the definition of it. It says all operations are executed in some sequential order, and each process issues operations in program order. This is basically saying, I'm going to assume that all my writes across all the sites have basically are being getting ordered just as you did in your totally ordered multicast. Okay? But within each process, I want to essentially preserve program order. Across processes, I don't know what order writes are occurring, but I will assume some order and everybody agrees on that order. Okay, so any valid interleaving is allowed, all processes agree on that interleaving, but the process must preserve program order. This is best understood as an example here. Okay? So here you have a write, so X is your data item that, let's say it's a web page. Okay? So X is your web page. W of X says I'm writing to that web page. X, okay? And A says I wrote value A to that web page. Maybe I updated it with a character A. Okay? I just, at some later time, I wrote B to that web page. Okay? Now, E3 is going to read that web page, okay? And it first got B. Okay? And then the second time it read it, it got A. Okay? And this, when P4 read it, the same thing happened. So you should say, is this allowed or not allowed? Normally, if you had a global clock, you would say this write occurred first, that write occurred second. Why is this process seeing B? Once it sees B, it should not see A. That's what you would assume. Okay? But we don't have actually a synchronized clock, so we don't really know, because these two processes didn't communicate. We don't know which those are actually concurrent events in reality. Okay? So the processes just agreed that this write has happened before that write because there's no other way to. Concurrent, although in time order they don't seem concurrent, but those processes don't communicate, so they're concurrent. So they assume that this write actually occurs before that write, that's the interleaving you agreed on, and both processes have seen the same interleaving. That should be allowed under sequential consistency, but not under strict consistency. Okay? What is not allowed is what is shown here. Same example, but when P3 reads this web page, first it sees the update B. Then it sees the update A. When P4 sees the update A first and B. So they are seeing the updates occurring in two different orders. That's not allowed. But that would violate your global ordering where you said A happened before B or B happened before A. You have to agree on that, okay, for concurrent events. And then everyone sees updates in that order. Is that clear? Yes, your question?
But wouldn't process one get maybe B later, because
what's your question? Is process one going to get B later?
Yes, whereas P3 and P4 are seeing B and A, like we are assuming that that is the sequential order that all the processes are observing. But wouldn't process one, because of its local, like it has process A first, it would see A.
The question is, this is a good question. The question is, process one has written to the web page. Okay? So why does it not sit A before B? It will actually process A before B, but the question is when this update B arrives, P1 has to decide, did that update occur before your update or not? It's like totally ordered multicast. You've written a write, but you have to wait for all the writes to figure a global ordering and then commit them in that order. Okay? So in this case, all processes agreed that this write has occurred before that write, so you will commit them in that order, and that's the order in which you're going to see. Okay? What is not allowed is once you agree on that ordering, you cannot have them see different orders in different processes. That is not allowed in sequential consistency. Okay, so it assumes that sequential operations, you agree on an operation and you just go about showing the reads in that order. Okay. Linearizability has one more requirement, which says that if you have events across processes that are related by a message, like you have in Lamport's clock, you essentially also respect Lamport clock's ordering when you derive that ordering. Okay? So if timestamp of A or X is less than the timestamp of Y, that ordering that you decide, operation X should precede operation Y, otherwise you are not going to get linearizability. That's a stricter property than sequential consistency. In sequential consistency, you say any interleaving is arrived, I don't care if this process communicates with that other process, I can still say B happened before A. But if there's actually a message that imposes that dependence, I want to actually respect that dependence when deciding the interleaving. That's what your totally ordered multicast does. Okay? It actually gives you this property because you are actually using Lamport's clocks as well. Okay? So here is an example of totally or linear visibility. These processes that are basically setting values of x, y, and z. There are global variables. Let's say there are processes that can set values of x, y, and z. So they are writing to x, writing to y, writing to z, and then they are printing what the other two variables. In this case, they are reading. Okay? Print means you read y and read z from your shared data structure and print. Okay, now here is essentially an interleaving of those print statements and signatures. Okay? And so here what you've done is essentially your x. So this interleave says these statements are going to execute in that global order. That said, those statements are going to execute in that global order and so on. And all of those interleavings are actually valid because the processes are not directly communicating other than just reading and writing. Okay? You just decide on an interleave. These are the interleaving. So you get essentially that's what is getting printed. So you print YZ at this point, it's still 0, 0. Then you print XZ is probably 1, 0, and YZ is just 1, 1. Okay, based on that interleave. If you have that interleaving, you print that interleave. So all of those interleavings will be allowed and they will be called consistent with respect to linear assembly. Okay, is that clear? So you basically just have these programs, you interleave them, you saw the output. So long as you have those properties, let's say any interleaving is allowed, all processes agree on the same interleaving, each process preserves its program order, so you can't flip statements in the program. Okay. And furthermore, if that is true, if time stop of x is less than time stop of y, that should appreciate. In that case, essentially what that says is this print statement, if you're going to read x and z, you basically want to make sure that you basically preserve that property. Okay, because as implicit communication between when you set the value and when you read that value. Okay. So this is linearizability. It is a stricter form than sequential consistency. So strict consistency is the strictest form. Sequential consistency is weaker than strict consistency. Linearizability sits between strict consistency and sequential consistency. Okay. So here is yet another form of consistency. This is called causal consistency. Okay, this can be also understood best with an example. Basic property here is causally ordered writes must be seen by all processes in the same order. But concurrent writes can be seen in different order. Okay, this is even weaker than the other two. Okay. And here is an example of what this even means. Okay. So here is essentially three, four processes. You've written A here. You read this value, you got A. Okay, which means that whatever was written is seen here. And then you wrote B. Okay. This basically means this implicit message from P1 to P2 where you basically wrote a value to a data to X. And then when you read it, you got that value. That's like sending a message from A process 1 to process 2. Okay? So what that says is, this is, if you think about it as Lamport's clock, this write has preceded that write based on Lamport's clocks, because there is a read here between those two writes. Okay? So if that is the case, then all processes must see this write before that write. If you read it, you should actually see A followed by B, so this is not permitted. Because this process is saying B, A, that's saying A, B. Okay. So they both should have seen A, B, because these two writes are causally dependent on one another. Okay. However, if you take this read out, which is what is shown there, okay, you can actually see those writes in different orders. It says if the writes are concurrent, we don't want to order them, you can see them in whatever order. So in this P3, the update from P2 arrives first, and then the update from P1 arrives. In P4, the opposite is to update from P1 arrives and then P2 arrives. Okay? You will realize this is the same example that we had in two slides ago, okay, which is here. And in this case, this was not allowed. So you got to agree on an ordering. Everyone had to see the same order. You couldn't see different order. Okay, so you got to agree on some order, and that's the, this was not allowed. But in causal consistency, if those writes are concurrent, that's permitted. In this case, if the writes are dependent, then you have to respect that order exactly. You cannot flip it. Is that clear? Or should I explain that? Is it clear why the writes are dependent? Yes or no? Okay, there is no implicit message here. This is a, so rather, there's no explicit message here. This is an implicit message. Find and you see that value, that's essentially a message that's gone from process one to process through that file. Okay, you think of a shared data structure, you write a value, some other process goes and reads that value, that's an implicit communication. That is essentially what has happened here. So this is equal, this read is equivalent to P1 sending a message to P2. Okay. And then that write has actually happened after that P1. So these two writes are causally dependent. It's like Lamport's clocks, where you have a write, you send a message, and then you write two. Okay. So write one has happened before write two in this case. So all processes must see the effects of write one before they see the effects of write two. Okay, which is why you don't permit this ordering. You're just showing it in the opposite order. That's all it is saying. Okay, yes, question.
For the permitted instance,
yeah.
Is it possible that P3 and P4 would both only read B if the writes occurred? Or would they all, do you know what I mean? Do you understand what I'm asking? Like, is it possible that for the first and second read, they would both get...
So are you saying BA, is that enough? Is that what you're asking?
No, if they both got BB.
If they got both got BB.
Yeah, could that happen? Like, we write, and then we write again, and it just, we never get... Yeah? Okay.
You can. The question, that's a good question. The question, if you read it twice, can you both see BB? That's allowed, because in that case, what has happened is, this write happened first. Okay. This write happened second, and it overwrote the first content, and then you're reading that subsequently, and then you'll keep seeing B as many times as you read. Okay. Although this is type ordering, essentially this says that this read is actually in type order occurred here. That is why you see that in global time. Okay. Yes. Yeah, so that is perfectly valid as well. Any other question? You can also keep getting A. It simply means that you probably decided to order them the reverse way, and then you just keep seeing A. That's also fine. Any other questions on this? Okay. So that's causal consistency. So we are kind of done with most of the theoretical part. I'm going to talk about some other stuff, but there are few other models that are even weaker than this. Okay, so FIFO consistency says you only order the writes from one process. You don't even try to arrive at any global order. Okay? If a process issue keeps issuing writes, all you say is the writes from that processes are ordered. Across processes, you might get things in different order. Okay? So that's an even weaker form of consistency than we talked about before, where you're only respecting program order but nothing else. Okay? And then you can have other models as well, which I'm going to talk about. So, in most cases, what you do is, because interlaying these operations is hard, you will not even do them in this way. What you would rather do is you'll have synchronization points at which you'll synchronize everything. Okay? So this is equivalent to, I have critical sections. When I'm about to enter a critical section, I synchronize all the objects and make sure I have a consistent view of that object. Then I enter the critical section, so I have a consistent view. Or when I exit a critical section, I commit all the changes, so everything becomes consistent. But within a critical section or outside critical section, things may be out of sync with respect to it. Okay. So these are called entry and release consistency, okay, where you are not trying to keep things consistent across time. You're only making things consistent at certain points in time where you say, okay, things have gotten inconsistent, I'm about to enter a critical section, let me pause, let me synchronize everything. And once everything is synchronized, I'll proceed. Okay? Or when you exit a critical section, you will say, I'll pause, I'll synchronize everything, and then I'll exit as well. Okay? So these are other forms of consistency models that you will see, and this is used in many cases like databases. Okay, database transactions commit when you are actually finishing the transaction. In between, things may be out of sync, it doesn't matter, but when you commit, everything is synchronized. Okay? So that's the kind of model you will see there. Okay. Here's a table that summarizes everything, okay, whatever I talked about. This is all roughly in order of strict to weak. Okay, so your strict consistency, then there's linearizability, the sequential consistency, causal consistency, FIFO consistency. And then there are two forms of weak consistency which are only done at synchronization barriers. It's also called barrier synchronization in some cases where you say even though all of those things are too expensive, I only do it at certain points in my execution of processes. So those are all data-centric consistency model. I have one slide on what is called client-centric consistency, and then I'm going to talk about something that's even weaker than everything we have said so far. Okay. So in client-centric consistency, rather than looking at consistency from the perspective of replicas, you look at consistency from the perspective of a client. Okay. So let's say you have a phone or your laptop. Okay. You read some data. Okay. Then you move to a different location. Let's say you travel with your mobile device, go home. Okay. Then you read that data again. Okay. And the question is, what do you see? Okay. You should see something that is as new or newer than what you've seen before. You shouldn't see data that's older. Okay. Yet this happens all the time. Okay. If, let's say you have something like a DNS update. Okay. This happens in many different scenarios. So you might have made a DNS update in one network. So if you try to resolve to that IP address in one network, you will see the right data. Okay. You go home, maybe the DNS servers there haven't updated it. So you try to resolve it, you still see old data. Okay. So you don't want that. If you've already seen some new data, you don't want to go backwards in time and start seeing old data. This also happens when you do things like password updates in a large distributed system. If you go and update, let's say, your net ID, or you go and update your Unix password, okay, because there are many password servers, there are many directory servers that serve passwords. They don't keep themselves strictly consistent. You update your password on one LDAP server, it takes some time for it to propagate. Okay? So it might often happen that you update your password in one location, you go to another building, and you try to enter that password again, it will reject it because it still has the old password. Okay? So from a client's perspective, you already done something new, but when you go to a different location, the replicas still have old data, so they are serving the old data. Okay? So you don't want that to happen. So there are client-centric consistency models. And basically they say that if you start seeing a version of a data, you go to any other location, it doesn't matter what consistency model you have to at least see that data or the newer data, not older data. Okay? So from client's perspective, it looks like the system is behaving in a consistent way. Otherwise, you will have the problem I talked about where DNS update didn't propagate, your password didn't propagate. You think you change your password, you go somewhere else, it doesn't change. Okay? This also happens many times if you're logged into, let's say, the browser-based version of the application and an app-based version of the application. Okay? They might talk to different password databases. So if you update it in one place, it might take a little time for it that change to propagate. So you might not see the same thing. Okay? So you have things, there are multiple models here. Monotonic read says, once you read a value, you should see something new. Monotonic write says that if you made a change, that chain has to propagate everywhere, and you have to at least see that right. If not, you are right. Okay, so those are all client-centric consistency models, which allow you to not reason about how the replicas are propagating data, but what the client sees from the system. Okay, and from a user's perspective, that may be more important than what is happening internally. Okay, so we went through a whole slew of these things. I'm going to now, for the next 15-20 minutes, talk about a very weak form of consistency. It goes back to the earlier question about CAP theorem as to why you want to lack consistency at all. Okay. Everything we talked about, although there are weak forms of consistency and strict forms of consistency, still come at a very high overhead of consistency maintenance. Because I didn't tell you how all of those techniques can be implemented. I just gave you definitions. Say this is what strict consistency means. This is what linearizability means. Okay, implementing all of that in code is actually expensive and hard. So what many systems have done is they say, let's not worry about consistency at all. Let's implement something really weak. And one such system technique is called eventual consistency. Eventual consistency says, we will, updates will happen, we'll propagate them whenever we want. Eventually, everything will be consistent. That may take a long time. And in the meantime, things will be out of date with respect to one another. And that's okay. Right? So, because consistency maintenance is hard, that's the technique that most big systems, I shouldn't say most, many big systems actually take into. So DNS is a good example. All DNS updates are eventually consistent. Okay? They do pairwise updates. So you make an update, that server every hour will contact some other server every 6 hours and say, here are some more changes, and then transmit those changes. Okay, until then, those other servers are out of date. But over time, things will actually propagate through, then all the updates will propagate and you will have more recent versions of the data. But there's no guarantee as to how long it will take. This is why when you make a DNS update, you will see that most of the servers will say it will take up to 24 hours to propagate. Because in many cases, DNS servers contact other servers for update once a day. That's why it says 24 hours, saying it may take up to 24 hours. Sometimes it propagates faster, but it may take a long time. So there are many systems like this, directory protocols and DNS servers, and I talked about the password databases that do the same thing. They might synchronize every few hours. Until then, things are out of date. Yeah. So this is called eventual consistency, which means it's a very loose form of consistency. There are no guarantees at all. So eventually, things will become consistent. So for this consistency model, I'm going to show you some techniques that can actually be used to propagate this data. Okay, so let me, this is just saying whatever I already said, saying we'll have a replicated database. Okay, there are a few updates, many readers, and eventual consistency is in the absence of any new updates, eventually all these replicas will see all the writes and they will become consistent. Okay. So very cheap to implement because you're not implementing any consistency. Okay, and then there may be lots of problems here. Users go to another database, they start seeing out of date data and so on. Okay. But let me now explain how you can implement this. Okay. So eventual consistency is often implemented through what are called epidemic protocols. Okay. So these protocols are inspired by how diseases spread. So diseases spread often if you are, have a contagious disease. It spreads to pairwise contact. If you have a cold, you go shake someone's hand, you infect them. Okay? That person goes and does the same thing and infects other people. Okay? So that's how many diseases actually spread. Okay? So we want to use that idea to essentially spread updates. So you make an update in the system. You are doing eventual consistency. So we have plenty of time for that update to spread. What we are going to do is do pairwise exchange. Okay, server one will randomly pick another server, okay, at some point in time and say, here are some changes, and give it to that server. That server, and now the two servers have essentially this update, which means two servers are infected. So those two servers will repeat. At some random point in time, they will contact two other servers and say, here are some changes. And now that change keeps propagating through the network in this randomized fashion. Okay. Eventually, you want to infect all the servers in your system, okay, so that they will all have the update. This is why it's called eventual consistency. That may take a long time. So there may be some server that never gets picked, because you're randomly picking the server and say, here, some update. So, okay. So that's basically what epidemic protocols do. Now, many systems that you actually encountered in practice use this form of consistency. Okay? You may be familiar with Dropbox. Okay? Dropbox essentially is going to use this type of model, except that Dropbox has a centralized server. So you might have many Dropbox clients for your username and password. You make an update on one device, okay? Your Dropbox client at some point is going to contact the Dropbox server and say, here are some changes, and push it. It might also pull, saying, do you have any updates, and pull something. Okay, so you both push and pull in your pairwise. So now you are basically pushed your thing to the server. Some other Dropbox client that you have maybe on some other device will essentially go and pull the same data after some time. Okay? So you have this pairwise exchange of information between two machines. That's happening at some random intervals. There's no guarantee. Dropbox will also not give you any guarantee. Okay, if you make a change on one machine, if you're logged into Dropbox, say, make a change on one machine, see how long it takes for the other machine to see that. It might take a few seconds, sometimes it may take a minute, it depends on the settings of the client as to how frequently they are synchronized with the server. Okay? That's eventual consistency, there's no guarantee. Okay? That's what you live with, even though you expect that. If you make a change, it should propagate instantly. It doesn't happen that way. Okay? Many other cloud services also do the same thing. Any service that uses cloud synchronization, okay, in your phone, if you have a smartphone and you have an address book on your phone, yeah, and maybe on multiple devices, you will have the same pairwise exchange. You make add a contact on one device, you can watch how long it takes for that contact to show up on another device. It's going to take some arbitrary period of time because it is basically using this epidemic protocol theory to spread it, except that as a central point of contact, you're going to push to the server and the server might push it to others. Okay? But that thing can be generalized. You can do pairwise pushing. You don't have any centralized entity. You just contact an arbitrary other client or server and push it. Okay, your question?
So won't we be wasting a lot of computation over here? For example, A and B. So B is already updated. A keeps sending some updates to like B or C. So won't we waste a lot of computation in this?
Okay. The question is, will you waste a lot of, not as much computation, but a lot of messages trying to spread an infection? When do you stop spreading update? Okay? I'm going to talk about that in the very next slide. Okay? But the basic idea should be clear. Okay? How you are keeping things synchronized. This is fundamentally how any cloud synchronization protocol, whether you are using Dropbox or whether you are using contacts on your phone or any other thing, they are all using eventual consistency. That should also tell you that everything we talked about, strict consistency, is not really implemented in practice in many applications. Because users are willing to tolerate a delay of a few seconds, few minutes, sometimes even a few hours for your data to get synchronized. Is that clear? Okay. So now we'll talk about two specific algorithms, which was basically based on what you are mentioning. The first one is called anti-entropy, which is the example I used in the previous slide. Server P is going to pick server Q at random and it's going to exchange updates. So you can use a pull mode saying P picks Q and say, do you have any, I contacted you last 1 hour ago. Do you have any changes that have occurred since the last one? And you'll pull those changes. Okay? Or you'll say, I contacted you 1 hour ago. Since that 1 hour, these many changes have occurred. Here, take them. That's push. Okay? So you can push new data, you can pull new data, or you can do both. You can do two-way synchronization. Dropbox will do two-way synchronization. If you change something on your file, a file on your machine, it will upload that to the server, but it will also pull any changes that may have come from other clients. Okay, so you are doing push and pull. That's anti-entropy, only pull, or push and pull. And then what it says here is you have a random set of nodes. A pure push-based approach is not going to spread your updates quickly. So you have to ask, why is that the case? So let's say you have n nodes, okay? You make a change on one node. It will randomly pick another node and push that update. Now two nodes have it. Those two nodes will randomly pick some other nodes and push that update. So four nodes have it. So it will exponentially increase the number of nodes that have it. In the end, there may be a very small set of servers that still haven't seen that update. Okay? But the probability of picking those servers in a large system is 1 over n. If you have n nodes, which means for large n, that's a small probability. Okay, it may be that if you're using pure push, you keep picking nodes that have already seen that update and there is nothing to push if there's only one update in your system. Okay. So those some small number of nodes may not get that update quickly. You have to wait until some one of these infected nodes, which are the nodes that have seen the update, end up picking that node and pushing it. Okay. But if you combine push with pull, then that works much better because nodes are proactively pulling and also proactively pushing. Okay? So in the scenario that I was just talking about where there are small number of nodes that have not received the update, if you have both push and pull, that one node might actually pick one of the other nodes, and with high likelihood it will pick one that's already seen the update and pull the content, and you will have that update. Is that clear?
Yes, please.
So I will make an example here. So Let me use some color here. So let's say there is a set of nodes. So here is this node received a update, so it's B. Okay, so it basically contacted this node. That node also received that update. Okay, white nodes are the ones that are sending. So now four of these nodes are. So one node is left. Okay. Now if this node picks another node at random, okay, it might pick with the higher likelihood these other three nodes than that node, okay, because you're picking uniformly. So with 3/5 probability you'll pick these and 1/5 probability you'll pick them. And if you pick those other nodes, there's no data to transmit anymore because the root update has already been transmitted. So if you use only a push mode, after a while when there are small number of nodes that have not yet seen the updates remain, the probability that those nodes actually see the update will actually stay high because you're not picking them. If you just do pure push, I'll be trying this way. And now if you combine push and pull, that means every node is proactively not only pushing, but is also contacting other nodes saying, do you have an update? In that case, this node, every so often will contact one of the other nodes saying, do you have an update? Okay, so it might, in this case, it has to pick one of these others. So it will contact that and pull that change and it will get that.
Like an hour,
sorry?
Like an hour, like 2 hours.
Right. So every so often you're going to both push and pull. Okay, so if you combine push and all that is saying is if you combine push and pull, the updates will propagate faster. That's all it is saying. Okay, even in push, eventually that update will get pushed because probabilistically you will eventually pick that one node and push that update. But it's going to take you some time because you might waste a lot of effort picking other nodes first until that node gets picked. Okay, so that is anti-entropy. Okay. Rumor mongering is called also called gossip-based protocol. All these epidemic protocols also have this other term called gossip. Okay, so there are two things that are actually inspired this protocol. One is how diseases spread and how rumors spread. Rumors also spread the same way as diseases spread. You have some hot piece of news, you call your friends and start spreading that news, and then they will call others and start spreading it. It's the same approach, just as you infect other people. Okay? So this is called rumor mongering, which is basically inspired by this class of protocol called gossip protocol. They're same as epidemic protocol. Okay? With one small difference is in gossip protocols or rumor mongering, there is some probability you will stop. Okay? Just as initially if you have some hot news item, you try to spread it, but after a while you feel like everybody knows it. You stop calling friends saying, hey, I found this out, because they'll say, yes, I know that already. Okay. So just as you stop spreading your rumor because you feel that everybody knows it, there's no point spreading it. Same is true in this protocol, where what you're going to do is initially when you receive an update, P is going to contact a randomly chosen node Q and spread that rumor. Q will do the same thing. But after every round, you will toss a coin. Okay? And with probability 1 over K, you will say, I'm going to stop spreading that rumor because everyone knows it. Okay, that's why you're going to do randomized back off saying, so every time you spread a rumor, you'll say, I'll toss a coin, and if this says heads, I'll continue spreading the rumor. If it says tails, I'm going to stop. It's not half and half in this case, it's 1 over k and 1 over k minus 1 over 1 over k. So basically, you will probabilistically stop with probability 1 over k, and you can pick k. Okay? If k is 10, means after on average, after 10 attempts at spreading a rumor to 10 of your friends, you will stop saying, I think everybody knows it. If K is 100, you might actually contact 100 nodes before you stop, on average. Okay, that's a probabilistic estimate. Okay. So you have a parameter K that says, when does this stop? Okay. What that also means is, because if all nodes stop and there are some nodes here, this is a push-based protocol. Okay, you don't keep calling friends saying, do you have a rumor for me? That doesn't work. Okay, rumor mongering is purely push. There is no pull in a rumor mongering. Okay, so in this case, because if all nodes that have the rumor have tossed the coin and stopped, there is a non-zero probability that some node may not ever receive that rumor at all. So you'll have some nodes which will remain susceptible, which means they never hear it, and then the whole protocol stops spreading that rumor, and maybe a new rumor starts spreading. So that update is never received. Okay, so all of this, so by tuning the value of K, you can make this probability very small. That's the analysis saying what's the probability. It's an exponentially low probability, but it's a non-zero probability that some nodes will never receive the ruby. You had a question?
Is it that in anti-entropy, for lesser amount of communication, you can get it across faster? So for example, if one of them were just like pushing faster, like at a higher rate.
So I mean, so question is, can you actually push faster at a higher rate in anti-entropy? The rate at which you push or how frequently you push is a parameter you can set both in anti-entropy and rumor mode. You can say, once you have an update, do it once a minute, pick a node at random, once an hour. What you pick is really up to you. So both of those can actually control the rate at which they spread this updates. Okay? The only difference here is this has a probabilistic stop. In that case, there is no, you have to add some heuristic, the definition, the algorithm itself doesn't actually stop spreading your disease in some sense. Okay?
I guess you can come up with like a lot of ways of doing this, right? So are there empirical reasons why like these two have come up?
Okay, question is, there are many ways to do this, are there empirical reasons why these two? So you are absolutely right. This is an entire area of research. There'll be literally hundreds and hundreds of papers written on variants of this gossip protocols, weak consistency, eventual consistency. You search for these things, you will see a lot of papers on this. These are just two high-level ways by which those techniques work, but of course, every paper will have a different tweak on how it works and so on and so forth. Okay? So yes, I mean, these are by no means anything authoritative, they're just ideas that you can use to design a variety of different protocols.
I have a question regarding, like, so let's say it was a file and like people override it and updates are sent once every hour.
Yes.
How do you
that's a good question. The question is, if I understand your question, well, you are saying I change a file at location 1, some other node before that change has occurred changes a file at location 2, what happens? Okay. So that's a good question. In fact, I think that's the next slide. So that's actually still here. So the scenario that is being mentioned is called a write-write conflict. Okay? This will often occur. Okay, so you can actually see this occurring in Dropbox. Okay, so you can actually may do a simple experiment if you use Dropbox. If you log in onto Dropbox from two different machines, okay, go open the same file on both machines. Okay? Make two different changes and save the file more or less at the same time and see what happens. You will see that when both of those clients try to contact the server will see that the files are changed more or less at the same time. It will declare a write-write conflict and actually create two copies saying that the file changed at the same time. That can often occur in this case because their consistency guarantee is so weak, you can override changes. Yeah, that's what, in many of the other ones, you could have prevented that by ordering the writes. Here, the writes are occurring concurrently, you will have write-write conflicts. Okay. So, same thing, so the other thing I should mention is pairwise updates are also at the heart of what is done in source code control. When you have Git or other things, that's essentially what you're doing. You're doing pairwise exchange with the server or with one another. Okay? And the same thing can occur there. You might actually have a source file you modified, some other developer modified. You try to merge it, the merge fails, you get a write-write. Okay. The system cannot handle it. It will throw that exception to the user saying, there is some problem, you go figure it. Okay. So now there's one more thing that I should mention here, which is in most of the system, deleting files is also a problem. Okay. And the reason is the following. Let's say, I'm going to give the Dropbox example just to keep it simple. Let's say you go into Dropbox and you delete a file. Now, let's say a Dropbox client contacts a server saying, is there a difference? Do you have any data that I don't have? If you compare the two directories, okay, there'll be one file on the server that you don't have, which is the file you deleted. Okay? If you simply do pairwise exchange blindly, you will recreate that file because you'll say, I don't have this file X, and you are that file X. So you'll just bring it back. You see what I'm saying? So if you simply delete a file and it leaves no trace on your machine, you contact another machine, say, I have three files in this directory, how many files do you have? If you have four, you bring that file, assuming that file is new and you recreate it, thinking that's an update. Okay? So in other words, there has to be a way to distinguish between an update and a delete. A delete that leaves no sign of it will not allow you to figure out when you contact some other machine and that has still a copy of the file, whether there's a deleted file or there's a new file that got created. So the way you are going to actually work with through this is what is called a death certificate, which means you will delete the file, but you will keep an entry saying file X has been deleted. Okay? So delete is now an update that has to propagate and cause others to delete it as well. So you will basically now, rather than saying what file to, I will say I have an update to X and the final update is X has actually been deleted. So you should delete it also. Because if I simply delete it, I have no knowledge that it even existed. And I contact another server, you will bring it back. You will think that that's a new file. Okay, so you want to distinguish between files that are created that are new and files that are deleted. And actually, you don't do that without leaving a trace. So you are actually going to create this death certificate, which will propagate to the system and cause the files to be deleted. But there will be a record saying the file was actually deleted. Eventually, once the death certificate spreads everywhere, you can delete the death certificate itself. But that's a separate problem. So most of these actually have this problem. And early versions of these epidemic protocols suffered from this issue where if you did not distinguish deletion properly, you ended up recreating the data. Old data came back. Because when you contacted other server, it pushed you some changes. And here are some files you don't seem to have. And now your files just got recreated. So that's what was designed as a solution to that problem. Okay. So the thing to take away is there are many forms of consistency. Okay. Many of them are expensive to implement. So many distributed systems take the lazy approach saying, let's just make things eventually consistent. It's a very weak form of consistency. There may be conflict. We'll deal with that later. And they use these kinds of protocols, which are essentially epidemic protocols or gossip-based protocols, pairwise exchange. So that's the heart of epidemic protocol. Server I contacts server J, they do a pairwise exchange of information. And then that information keeps spreading in a randomized fashion. Okay? So we will stop here. We ran out of time. We will resume.